It's easy to see success stories like Six60s as charmed, fun and free. With anthems like Rise Up and Don't Forget Your Roots, Six60 was so popular, it was the first Kiwi group to sell out Western Spring Stadium to 50,000 fans. But the fame and success was hiding the truth. The band was unravelling, its members seriously struggling. Tonight, Six60 tells Tama Didi Mene Sproat how they asked for help and turned it all around.
New Zealanders have really, really taken ownership of us. We've grown a hell of a lot.
It's one thing we struggle to do is celebrate our successes.
660, New Zealand's biggest band. That almost didn't make it.
I think we had different ideas about what we were trying to do.
There was just like this friction.
We were just using alcohol to mask our insecurities.
I don't know if it's good enough, you know what I mean?
It started here, at the most famous house in the city.
And where are you guys from?
We've travelled up from Invercargill, but we're actually Canadian.
Who's your favourite band?
660.
What about you, Chief?
I'm just for the ride, mate.
You a 660 fan too, though?
Oh, I put everything, yep.
What do you think makes it so special?
I'll just get told to come.
660 Castle Street, Dunedin. For a while, it was home to Jai Fraser, Matu Walters and Eli Piaway.
I think, like, not as good as everyone thinks. Like, 660 wasn't the warmest flat in the world.
It was carnage, mate. It was like that movie, District 9. It was kind of like that. If you walk down that street on, like, a Friday, Saturday night, it's just carnage everywhere.
Amidst the carnage, they found time to write a couple of tunes. Haunted by the ghost of you, it won't leave me alone.
I've been desperately, this is forever, yeah. If they come, don't forget your roots, my friend.
Those tunes became anthems. A decade on, they're back.
Dunedin, what's up? You feeling good? Sound good, you look good. It's such a pleasure to be back here where it all started. You know, 660 is coming on.
But that success came with a price.
We were reflecting on our meteoric rise and how important Don't Forget Your Roots was to us arriving on the scene. I tell you, that song that brings you to the dance is the same thing that traps you, you know, if you don't treat it with the respect that it needs. And, you know, reflecting, we felt, oh, this song, when it came out, we were kind of trapped by it. You know, everyone was like, this is what we expect of you. You're this roots reggae band now, and all we did was judged on this one thing.
For a band that started in a flat, expectations became almost unbearable.
We sometimes laugh about the fact we had no right making a band, let alone being successful.
Stage is a good place to look at your demons. It really is confronting, walking out in front of people and performing and being who you really are.
At times, it's like when you're out in the public eye, it's like a huge magnifying glass is on you, watching your every move, you know, and sometimes even in the past, it was hard to be yourself.
I felt the feeling of, I've done so much, but I've done bugger all at the same time. And that was very difficult for me to get through too.
What was the lowest point for you in the band?
The lowest point for me was when we were living in Berlin. We went over to Berlin for like 6 months. And the band wasn't in good shape. We were kind of separate. We weren't talking to each other. Creatively, it was just dead.
New country, new label. The band was heading in a direction it didn't want to go.
Trying to write new music and then dealing with the label issues, the band started to kind of unravel.
How did you deal personally with those lows?
Drink. Anything, the substances, that was probably the first go-to because you didn't know, you didn't have the tools to deal with it.
We were like cowboys at the time and we needed to become professionals, you know?
Did you guys ever get to a point where you needed someone to come in and help you guys?
Yeah, like quite a few times. We've had a lot of help over the years, like friends and family that have helped us through hard times, but also really special people like Gilbert Anoka.
This man, credited with making the All Blacks culture great, mental skills coach Gilbert Anoka wanted 660 to be the greatest too.
I wanted to challenge them in that space. I wanted them to look beyond what their initial horizon was. I wanted to then also get them to understand who they were.
Once we were man enough to kind of open up to these things, that we probably better we had a mediator and someone who could facilitate this learning. And being Kiwi males, but big fans of the All Blacks, we always considered ourselves the All Blacks of music.
A lot of them were wrestling with their own identity and their connection to their whakapapa, to their whānau, to their whenua, and the wrestle that happens when those sort of things get tangled. And I talked to them about what we've done in the All Black environment, the power of vulnerability. When you're struggling, put your hand up, and when you're not sure, put your hand up. Look for those support networks that can help nourish you and can guide you and to take you to spaces and places that you may not think possible. So, to be honest, I was directly applying the principles to what I've done in the All Black environment and what we've done there to another extremely high-performing environment that was 660.
And coming to grips with their vulnerabilities paved the way for this. Till the lights go out. Till the Lights Go Out, 660's Tell All documentary.
How do you feel when you watch the film?
Well, I hate the look of my face and I hate the sound of my voice. It's not a great start, but when we watched it for the first time, I think we all cried our eyes out. We were like, holy shit, like, this happened and that happened and we've actually come really far. And so it was really emotional.
A lot of these stories, I mean, you probably haven't told anyone, right?
Yeah, most of it only the boys in the band really know.
Seeing yourself vulnerable on there and seeing everyone else's interpretation of the story has been like quite an eye-opener. Because we, you know, you don't often talk about, even between the band, you know?
Yeah.
A lot of things we've been through.
To be honest, man, it's really uncomfortable. Probably a bit more harder for me because I'm naturally a pretty quiet dude anyway.
It's quite heartbreaking at times.
Julia Parnell, the documentary's director, saw power in the band opening up.
There's just a couple of moments in there that I think would make anybody cry. For 660, the biggest band in the country, you know, young men at the height of their career, to be ready to talk about self-doubt and vulnerability and conflict in the way they have, I think is really quite special.
When we first saw the first edit, yeah, we were crying the whole time and hugging, and it just had this crazy bond after viewing it.
Oh, what a wonderful example when you've got superstars understanding that being vulnerable is a superpower.
The sun has gone away. Clouds are hanging over me.
How do you think that will impact how Kiwi males, Māori males in particular, open up to vulnerability?
You know, if one of the offshoots of their wonderful music and their what they're doing on the music stage is to show that part of their journey is the opening up and sharing and the vulnerability, well, what a gift to the world.
660, New Zealand's biggest band. The band that made it.
We are a group that's constantly trying to grow, like not only as musicians or in our job, but personally as well. Like we're always looking to be better people.
Do you guys still struggle with that concept of bearing all in?
100%.
It's an ongoing process, and what I've realised is constant maintenance. You can't arrive at a place and go, I'm now forever mentally stable. This is going to be a constant. It's like a going to the gym and working on your muscles. Do you have to do the same for your mental health?
The thing I'm most proud of about our band, like, after going through tough times, we seemed to be stronger straight after that. At the end of the day, we just ended up sticking together and still here.
Very brave. Well, the 660 documentary, Till the Lights Go Out, is in theatres in a fortnight on November 26.